Subscribe to our YouTube channel, News Now Nation, for in-depth interviews and press the bell icon so you do not miss any of our updates.
Hi guys, welcome back to the News Now Nation channel. Today we're extremely excited. We're talking to Mr. Abhinav Mittal, who is the founder of the World Grad, which calls itself the passport to global education. We're going to understand a little bit more about his company, his vision, and how he looks at the whole education space internationally. So we're really excited to talk to you. Thank you so much for taking out the time.
Thank you, Mishri, for having me and talking to me today. Awesome. Glad to be here.
Awesome, brilliant. So before we start talking about the company and before we start talking about what you actually do there, I would love to hear a little bit more about your education and how sort of that impacted the role you play today in the education space.
Sure. So I am, that typical Indian path of engineering, MBA, going through competitive exams simply because I just did not know anything better. So I did my undergraduate from IIT Delhi. Then I went on, I worked for a few years, went on to do my MBA from the Indian School of Business. And after I graduated from business school, I started work with a consulting company called the Parthenon Group, which later on was acquired by Ernst & Young. And I set up their, part of the founding team of their education practice, education consulting practice. And that is how I got into education. So before that, I had never thought of education from a sort of a, as a sector. I mean, of course, it's a services industry at the end of the day, but it's not necessarily always commercial or business oriented. But there's a new side to education that I started discovering during my time at Parthenon. And also identified a lot of opportunities that are growing. Like, this was back in the mid 2000s, online education had just started knocking on the doors. Very early stage, we had seen the phenomenon of MOOCs coming up, which was supposed to disrupt the way university education will be, but obviously that did not turn out that way. At the same time, there was another phenomena that picked up during this time, especially post-recession, was international education. Mm-hmm. So, we started hearing more and more of students going to countries like Australia and UK and Canada, not just to the, not going to just the US Ivy Leagues and, top end colleges, but more as a mainstream option. And I could relate to that because when I was growing up, I was, it was very competitive. You had only one option, right? You do your IIT JEE exam. You are one amongst, in my time, I think there were some 200,000 students. I'm sure that number has skyrocketed since then. And you are completely. And that is all we knew. And it was like, if you get into IITs, you are set. If you don't get into IITs, you are then fighting out for very prestigious, non-engineering colleges. But for that, you need to have very high marks. And that was it. That was the end of the world. Otherwise, you have to then, your second shot would come with CAT. That would be your, the second exam. So that was the thing. But as in the last 15 years or so, I realized that there's a lot more opportunities. If I put things in perspective, unfortunately, our best educational institutions don't really end up ranking anywhere at a global level. So if you look at the top 500 universities in the world, we have only got seven representatives, seven. Whereas in India, we have 50,000 colleges. But that means that for students who are not able to go through this really arduous journey, not because they don't put in the hard work or they're not smart, but because this is so competitive, there are other good options out there.
Yeah.
And that actually has led to what I'm doing today in the World Grad. We're actually making overseas education more accessible to students.
Yeah.
So going overseas does not need to be a situation where only if you have potloads of money that you have to be there. We are creating a more economical, smarter way to go overseas by leveraging online learning. Mm. So that's what we're going to do. But this is a bit about my background and how I sort of got into this space and what we are doing today.
Right, right. That is incredibly interesting. And what you said is so true. I think it is always considered so important, the that you know, that 12th standard phase is, because people say if you don't get into a good university, you won't get a good job and it's going to impact the rest of your life. And you're right, it's such a competitive space for a 17 year old who might not, you know, still have that hustle, still have that work ethic. Mm-hmm. And you cannot say that, okay, how you spend the summer of 12th standard is going to impact the rest of your life. So it is so important to make good colleges available to everybody, good education available to everybody. And you're right, international education is not something that only like super rich kids do anymore. It is something that you see more in middle class families saving up to allow their children to go abroad. So given that, you know, there are a lot of advantages that come with studying abroad. One is, you know, maybe higher quality education. As somebody who's trying to get more people, and can I say more Indian students to go abroad, what do you think is the biggest bottleneck that you would face as, you know, as a company or as somebody who's trying to create this push or trying to create, I would say, almost this paradigm shift in the mindset of Indians and as part of this entire journey?
Right. Yeah, I mean, that lots of challenges, right? Lots of bottlenecks. But I'll just talk a little bit about it. So first of all, what does our company do, right? So our WorldGrad is actually a platform where we have partnered with global 500 universities to create online programs which are accepted as a part of their first year degree and first year undergraduate degree. So basically, what you can do is you can start an online program with us, study with overseas educators, you get great support, you have a fully online teched out content library at your disposal, which is at international standard. And when you complete it, that part of your education is then recognized by our partner institutions for as part of their first year or maybe up to a year. So that's what we do. So we are not consultants. We are not education agents or anything like that. We are actually academic program partners. Uh-huh. So we are creating these hybrid learning experiences for the student. And for us, you know, there are multiple bottlenecks. So first, obviously, is this concept itself is very new. And in COVID, it has, you know, kind of everybody is learning online and everybody is, you know, whether you're learning with Harvard or you're learning with IIT or you're learning with, you know, St. Stephen's College or whichever, it does the St. Xavier's or whichever college, everybody's learning online. So they don't see any difference between, like, today, if I talk to parents, they first are like, okay, but what is so different about it? And I said that, look, the learning experience, the online learning experience itself is very different because it is bespoke. It has been created with a technology platform. This is not about doing Zoom and PDF, PPT kind of things. You have all the, you know, mobile friendly content. You've got classes in your time zone from overseas faculty members. You've got very good tutorship, one-to-one tutorship that we provide to students as well. So there's lots of bells and whistles making a really nice learning environment. So that's the first hurdle, is explaining what online education is to a parent of a, you know, 17-year-old or 18-year-old and how that would play out, given so much of baggage that they are coming with in the last pandemic. Second issue is, sorry, Mishu, you are on mute, I think. The second challenge is that there is a lot of disinformation in the market. Now, normally study abroad, there are two kinds of students. One are these, you know, top-end smart students. You know, they will go to the best colleges and universities, the top, you know, top 10, 15, 20 universities. They don't need anyone's help. They know what they want to do, they go. And there's a long tail of students who take the help of education consultants and admission counselors, etc. And there, within that, there are some really good people. And then, like everything, there's a long tail of people who perhaps, you know, are more commission-driven or are, you know, are looking, maybe they are just sort of a little bit more on immigration sort of services. Now, what that does is that it creates a lot of disinformation in the market, because they will talk about not necessarily what's best from an educational standpoint,
absolutely,
but what's best from sending the student overseas standpoint, right?
Yeah.
And therefore, you know, what we also endeavor to do is we try and clarify, and it's not an easy process. Any overseas application is a complicated process because you have to apply, you have to understand what the university requirements are, but then you have to go through an assessment process on your candidature. your visa, things like that. And you have to take tests in between to prove your English standards. Yeah. A lot of things. What we also try and do is we create a service, almost like a single window application process, wherein once the student applies to us, we can then take care of the entire rest of the journey with this, with the university, helping them with everything else and making it very transparent and clear so that it's not ambiguous. And it's not, you know, just that I don't know what you're doing. So that's the second hurdle, is reducing disinformation and making it clearer. Now, the third bottleneck, obviously, is a general bottleneck. Comes back to the earlier point around pricing. Still, you know, no matter what you do, overseas education is a very large commitment for any family, whether it is a middle income household or upper income household. And normally, if a student wants to go overseas, their family is looking to spend anywhere from 60-70 lakh rupees upwards. Yeah. So it's a big number. Yeah. A lot of families, so there comes the third hurdle, where is financial education or counseling in terms of what are your options and whether you are, how suitable or how prepared you are to undertake this journey. Because family should not come under undue burden, or students should not come under undue burden. Because of this, you know, it can be very stressful. So what we do is, of course, our online program component, first off, reduces the cost of education. So our online program is priced at about a third of what the university on-campus education would be, but without compromising on the education quality. So you're not on the campus, but you are still learning from this, you know, overseas teachers, you're still learning the same curriculum. So it's not compromising on the education, but yes, the campus experience is not there, but you're also ending up saving a lot of money just because of that. Yeah. Secondly, because you are doing that online learning or starting your degree online, what you also do is you're saving on living expenses. Yeah. Living expenses are a very big component of any overseas education. So you can save that a little bit as well. So what it does in totality is, number one, that 50, 60 or 70 lakh rupees minimum that I spoke about earlier, it brings that down by about 25%. So that's the first thing that it does. Our programs are in making it more financially inclusive for parents and families. Yeah. The second thing that we do is we also educate them on what are your financing options, whether they are scholarships or there are loan facilities, because that's also a process that we have to invest to educate families that you can do this. And a lot of families everybody thinks that we can get 100% scholarship and nobody wants to take loans. That's the mindset of people coming in. Yeah. Reality is that there are no 100% scholarships in undergraduate education for international students. It's very rare. And loans are actually not a bad way to sort of facilitate this. So educating the families is that that's around their financial options and making it more inclusive is the third bottom. So these are the three things that we typically work on. So we are obviously first on explaining about online learning, number two, fighting disinformation, and number three, the most important part is financial education.
I think this past year and a half, everything has been online, and whether you're part of the academic programs you have created in that variety or not, everything has had to shift online, and the whole concept of an online course has really changed in the past year and a half with the pandemic coming in and with entire social distancing norms. I know for a fact that I was in university for all of last year and all of it had to be switched online, and there was a little bit of a feeling of that, oh, but this is not designed to be taught online. The professors weren't trained to teach online. So there sometimes was a feeling that is some part of my academia being compromised, or is this enough? Am I actually learning? So I understand those fears. They are very valid. Secondly, when we talk about debt, you know, student debt is it's an epidemic in America. You know, it is so problematic and so many people are in debt all their lives. And in India, the concept of debt, especially student debt, is very, very rare. Nobody wants to go into debt. So I understand these bottlenecks. They're very valid concerns of parents. In terms of creating solutions, of course, you know, you can talk about loans, but when it comes to consulting, there also becomes a huge, like, there's a fiduciary relationship, you know, between the consultant and the student. So in terms of understanding what's best for the student, is there like a standard way of figuring out, you know, what works best for who? Or is it just The counseling process, how does that process work?
Yes. So, I mean, this is the extra effort that we as a company have to put in, because typically, as in is kind of an online program provider, you know, my role or my company's role is obviously to get them started on the first year. But that's not where our role ends. We cannot recruit or enroll students who will not be able to fulfill the entire 3 or 4 years of education, right? So therefore, we as our team has to invest that time upfront to ensure that we get the right students and take them through those steps that they can, they are not just prepared for the online component, but actually prepared for the overseas component. Now, this requires a lot of training of our admissions staff. So we run an admissions team and we have to train them on understanding the student and the family's concerns, what kind of sources of income they have, you know, what is there, whether they have property, is it farming, it is commercial, their business family, what concerns they have, which part of the country they come from, you know, the way you speak is to, with, you know, the concerns of two families coming from the north is very different from the south, which is very different from the west. So there are a lot of sort of these nuances, but ultimately it is this whole process. But as I said, like all of these processes, the three things that I explained to you, all of these three elements, some people come to us and say, look, we don't have any money constraint, right? When you at the beginning, and when we go deeper and deeper, then we realize that actually there are constraints, or they will be sensitive, right? They will be sensitive to the fees. Everybody is looking for the best deal, essentially. Yeah. Like, why would I pay more if I can pay less,
yeah,
right? That's always the situation. So understanding those nuances, for we have to invest in a lot of training of our admissions team. And we are, you know, we get a lot of inquiries. We get, you know, over 1,500 inquiries a week for our programs. 1,500 inquiries a week that we get. And we had never imagined that we will get this kind of response. So there is a lot of curiosity amongst students around this concept. But I think it also requires a lot of education.
Yeah.
So we invest a lot of time creating that awareness amongst students who inquire. And, you know, now we are, you know, but we are very confident that, you know, this, I like any new program or new options that come out, you have to invest into creating that threshold level of awareness, threshold level of understanding and credibility before you are able to sort of, you know, make your, you know, your life becomes easier, which is, you know.
I think information is so empowering. And again, as you know, anybody who's gone through that, you know, 12th standard phase when you're 17 or you're 18 years old, and, you know, you've been told that you have to make this massive decision that's going to affect you for the rest of your life. It is an extremely, like, overwhelming time, I would say, for any student. And I know it was an extremely overwhelming time for me. I wanted to ask you, so at the end of the day, when you're working with children in that age group, you're dealing with some extremely vulnerable people, and people who are very afraid and who are very, for the lack of a better word, easily manipulated and sort of easily impressioned. And it's great, you know, that you invest so much in education, that you have this admissions team in place, that you have all these people in place that, you know, creates that sort of respect that this time deserves, because at the end of the day, what you do really, really, really does impact one's life. So I want to ask you, you spoke a lot about the parents and the role of convincing the parents, understanding the family. What is the role of the student in this entire puzzle and in the grand scheme of things here?
Yeah, so our conversations start with the student, and the student is the ultimately, you know, if I put it in business parlance, right, the student is the consumer, but the parent is the customer,
buyer,
right?
Correct.
So the customer buyer is the buyer, right? So you have to balance both. You have to satisfy both. What we find is that students today are very smart. They spend a lot of time researching. They come up with, you know, all sorts of questions, but ultimately they have to listen to what their parents have to say, because they cannot, you know, they cannot make this decision unilaterally. We had a student, you know, I was talking to her. She would call me in parallel while we are talking to her mother, or, you know, because she was, you know, they would, but the mother would not agree, is not agreeing on her choice of program.
Yeah.
While the student thinks that, no, I can do it, but the mother thinks, no, you cannot do it.
Yeah.
There are all these nuances that you have to balance. See, at the end of the day, it is a family decision. So you have to respect that. So both parent and the student have to be involved. So our journey starts always with the student. So first thing that we do is we first want to understand what does the student want? What is their desire, ambition, etc.? And why are they talking to us? Very often that itself tells us a lot about their intentions, but also their family dynamics and the concerns of their parents. When we have our first conversation with the parent usually the first question that the parent will ask is, oh, but why does he need to go overseas to study? How is Indian education compared with British education? Because they start from ground zero. That students have researched and they said that, look, I want to, you know, my board results are coming out, you know, in a few days time. I want to create my options in case whatever, you know, let us cutoffs go high, because this time also there is more uncertainty, right? Because school marks are being used. Absolutely. Partly. Absolutely. So students are a little bit more concerned. They're not very sure what's going to happen. So they don't know what the acceptances of the universities will be. They don't know how the normalization will be done of their marks. It's quite out there. Okay. So students are doing a lot of research and they're building options for themselves. Like, what happens if I don't get in? What happens if I, you know, if my marks are not good or I don't get into my program of my choice? Okay. What is my plan B? Or sometimes it is plan A to go overseas. The parent doesn't do that much research, right? They're still figuring out, okay, you are asking me to spend 50, 60, 70 lakh rupees. Let's justify that first. So that is a large majority of our parents. There is another section of parents where it is the other way around, where the parents are sure, I want to send my child overseas. They will do a lot of research and they will be like, this is the best option. But that's a minority. That's a smaller group of parents where the parents will come in very researched. But mostly to the student doing a lot of research. There are so many resources available to themselves. They can read up rankings, blogs, etc., etc. They have lots of questions about what they want to do. But it's the parent who ultimately also needs to be convinced. Absolutely. So we focus on both.
Yeah.
And that's very critical.
Yeah, I think that is very critical. And, I think the role of a company like yours ends up being very mediatory between parent and child also. Like, you know, okay, you want this, you want this. How can we figure out a way that both are satisfied and both are happy? Because as a child's life and as a child's, you know, next 4 or 5 years or 3, 4, 5 years, and the parents' life savings probably. So both these parties need to be satisfied, and it is incredibly important. That is incredibly cool. Just as we move towards concluding whatever we have to say, as somebody who has spoken to so many students, I'm sure, and so many parents, I'm sure you've spoken to countless amounts of them, and heard so many experiences, is there anything that you think you would like to tell parents, and you would like to tell parents, especially who have children in that age bracket, and something you would like to tell students who are in that age bracket, trying to figure out what they want to do?
Yeah, I think I have a couple of points maybe to share with folks. Is that number one? I think we have already, as a society in India, we have expanded beyond just engineering and medicine to lots of other programs. I think that I can say today that we have started moving beyond that. But I also think that in a similar fashion, parents should move a little bit further beyond and say that there is a world beyond the Harvard and the Stanford. There are many other colleges, good colleges around the world. There is also a question of, I never say that it's not that you shouldn't study in India. Studying in India is great, but if you have the means, you should at least explore opportunities which are more global in nature, because the world is becoming more global in nature. Absolutely. And there are advantages that students can get. And even today, it's not that once a student, earlier it used to be this norm that, oh, my son or my daughter has gone to the US and they will forever live there. That's not the case anymore. In fact, what we are seeing increasingly is that after spending 4, 5, 6 years, people are coming back to the home country as well. So that norm is changing also alongside. So now you have more globally mobile citizens or students who are globally mobile. And I think getting an overseas education has its advantages and you should definitely consider it. The second thing, though, is that if you are considering it, companies like ours and many others and many universities and colleges, they're all coming up with very interesting ways of giving access to overseas education. So you don't need to stick to that very traditional, I will get on, you know, go to US or go to, you know, Australia or UK and spend 3-4 years over there. There are various different ways like we do. You can start your studies here in India. You can learn, you can actually, almost you can academically bridge the gap between Indian education system and an overseas education system by doing programs like ours, which will actually make you more successful. One of the facts that a lot of students don't know or are not aware who are aspiring to go overseas is that 1 out of 3 students from India end up failing in at least one subject in their first term in an overseas university or campus.
My goodness.
And that is because, and one out of three and 1 out of 4 will fail in at least 2. Now, why does this happen? It's not because these students are not smart. It is because they are distracted. Once you go overseas, you are in a new country, new environment. Everything is new. Studies are absolutely new. You are learning in a, you know, the accent could be different that the teacher speaks in. The curriculum is obviously different. The way of education is different. Your living situation is different. Your friends are different. You may not have friends. You're struggling on every aspect. And that, all of those things have an impact on your studies. The studies are the ones that suffer.
Yeah.
With programs like ours, you can be smart because you can actually overcome, you can become very good with the study part of it while you're still in the comfort of your home. Yeah. So that when you go there, you can then figure out who I'm going to hang out with and where I'm going to live and how I'm going to, you know, manage my food and things like that. So it's all, it has, these programs have got advantages because you show up there, you fail 1 or 2 subjects, you are under financial stress, you're under mental stress, right? Yeah. You start figuring, oh, what should I do? Is this a wrong choice? Should I come back? Should I go to another program? What should I do? You start questioning yourself and putting stress on yourself. If you're better prepared, then so consider both, consider an overseas education as an option, but also consider smart ways of going overseas.
Absolutely.
So both things.
I think a really important thing about creating this hybrid system that you spoke about is primarily just educating people and telling them something like this exists and this is an option and you can get the best of both worlds, I would say. Best of both worlds, you can get, you know, some of the really good parts of having the experience about of studying abroad, global opportunities, global networks, and you can also have, you know, a reduced cost and some of the other benefits that, you know, learning online. I think learning online in itself is a important life skill, is something I've learned in the past year.
Correct.
Because I know how much I have struggled in those classes because I did not have the patience. I used to just want to shut my laptop and I used to not be able to sit through them. So I think all of these are important skills and it is something worth putting into your options as a student and as somebody, you know, who is looking to build a global career for themselves. So, all right, that was a lot of fun to learn about. Anything else you would like to add before we close?
No, I think, thanks again for giving me this opportunity to talk about what we are doing. Please do visit our website if you want to. It's theworldgrad.com and see the kind of universities we are partnering, the programs we offer, more than 100 undergraduate qualification routes into Australia, Dubai, UK, and very soon we are going to start our US programs as well. So we are essentially creating a portfolio of options for students to explore and pick with interesting programs in you know, obviously in the evergreen spaces like business and management, but also in, you know, upcoming spaces like cybersecurity. We've got sports management, event management, we've got hospitality, tourism. So it's not just the, like I was saying, going back to my experience from, you know, 20 plus years ago, it's not just about engineering, MBA. You have, today the world has evolved, moved forward. And I think that's what we're pushing. Yes, you can always do the traditional stuff, but there is a lot more. There are more than different universities, different destinations, different programs.
Absolutely.
And different ways of studying. And different ways of studying. And that's what the World Grad is. It's a new way to study overseas.
Brilliant. I am going to put, we're going to put the World Grad, the website link in our description. So anybody who wants can check it out and learn more about what the company does and how exactly it works. We have a really cool website. I've spent a little bit of time on it. So I hope this helps somebody. I hope there are students and parents watching this who understand there is this new way of learning that gives you everything probably that you are looking for. And it was an incredible experience talking to you, Abhinav. Thank you so much for taking out the time. Thank you for your contribution to the education space. You're helping Indian youth, and in that you're helping India. So thank you so much. And guys, we hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, let us know if you have any other questions for Abhinav, and we will reach out to him and make him answer them again. And thank you so much for watching, everybody.